Phantom, I don't know if there is a best way to start this panel. I don't know if there is, because I'm looking at all these great people out here. I'm looking at our amazing panelists that are about to come up here. And I think the only way we can start this properly is to get some energy in the room. What do you say?
I think we got the perfect word for this, actually.
What is it?
We're going to give them a good old get over here. Can I get everybody in the crowd? We're going to yell, get over here in 3, 2, 1.
I think that sounds like some good stuff. Welcome one and all to the Mortal Kombat Reunion Panel. Y'all ready for a great time here? Y'all ready for something special? My name is Corey. I'm the MC of the main stage.
And I am the Mortal Kombat Phantom, host of the Realmcast, Mortal Kombat Online's official podcast, and we are happy to be here today.
We are happy to have you as well. And here today, we are going to be welcoming some big names and some big excitement. So today, you all have a very important job because we want you to be excited and to show your love of this franchise. Now, before we get the people on stage who are going to introduce our very special guests, I want to point out a few special people in the room. Right there in the back is my friend Abby. She's waving her hand right there. Now, should you want to ask a question of this panel, we only have a little bit of time for audience questions. So if you're interested, she's walking around right now with a QR code. You can just put your hand in the air while she's walking around. You can scan that, and that question will be logged. And if we have time, we're going to get to a few of those questions.
That's right. And my co-host is also somewhere in the audience with another QR code.
He's right up here.
So make sure you get your questions in, because like we said, there's not much time.
There's just so much hype to go around, and I know two people that have that hype, and I think we have to welcome them to the stage. Everyone, please welcome back to the main stage, the final boss, Tom Jenkins, and of course, with Raiden Science Foundation, Tommy Pham. Gentlemen, please come on up. All right, these guys are a very important part of making all this happen. So gentlemen, please, if you could, let's introduce those special guests.
Sounds good, Corey. All right, first up to the stage is none other than game developer, versatile actor that portrayed amazing Mortal Kombat character in MK3, such as Cyrax, Sector, Nightwolf, and Cyborg, I mean, can't even say it right now, Cyborg Smoke, and other amazing characters such as Scorpion and my favorite, Raiden. Please welcome Sal DeVita.
Round two, here we go. Next up, got iconic actress who brought you Sonya Blade in Mortal Kombat 3 and Kia in Mortal Kombat Anthologies. We've got the infamous and great friend of the show, Kerry Hoskins. Let's hear it.
All right, next up, we have the honor of welcome a legendary artist, concept creator, and the original mind behind the Mortal Kombat lore. Please welcome the co-creator of Mortal Kombat, John Tobias.
Let's go. And last, but most certainly not least, CGC proudly welcomes fellow co-creator of Mortal Kombat, renowned developer, and Guinness World Record holder for longest voice acting in video games, Mr. Ed Boon.
Phantom, we're on the same stage as these four. Can you believe it?
I know. It's royalty right up here right now.
Well, feel free, friends, if you want to grab those microphones from the stands. They're all ready for you. And, you know, Phantom, I think since you are part of that Realm cast, I think you should have the first question, sir.
All right. Well, this question goes out to all four of you. And basically, I mean, it can mean a lot of things to a lot of different people. But what does Mortal Kombat mean to you?
I think it's a great way for people to get together, do something exciting and fun, and have a fantasy of really just beating the crap out of the person next to them. That's the way I started. It was like a great stress reliever for me anyway. All right, next. That's all I got, sorry.
I suppose I would summarize Mortal Kombat as something that's been part of my life longer than it's not been in my life. You know, John and I made the first game. We were in our 20s, and now we're not in our 20s. And so, like, it's been something that I don't think either of us would have expected to have lasted as long as it has. And, you know, I really, I'm hoping that at someday it's considered, you know, you've used the term forever franchise, where it's just something that just lasts, kind of like DC and Marvel and Star Wars, something that just kind of keeps going on. So it's been a part of my life longer than it hasn't, and it's allowed me to kind of, you know, celebrate with good people like you all.
Very similar to Ed, I think that I would not have guessed all those years ago that I would be on a stage, 55 years old, talking about this game that I created, you know, along with Ed and the team. I think I was 21, 22 years old, you know, when we started it. And so it's just the whole experience has been surreal, but it means a lot to me for it to still be relevant. And I think that, of course, all of us owe a huge debt of gratitude to, you know, Ed and the team at NetherRealm for kind of keeping it alive and relevant. And just happy to be a part of it and happy that I contributed what I did. So, yeah.
For me, it's a great way to live eternally, don't you think? I mean, it's been 30 years. April 1994 is my first shoot in Mortal Kombat, Sonya Blade. And it keeps just getting stronger and stronger every year. You guys, the fan base is amazing, and you guys are all just immortal, I swear. And we all really appreciate that, keeping it alive.
And I think that is what is probably most striking to me about the Mortal Kombat fan base as you're speaking, Carrie. It's strong in just how much it connects over the shared experiences, as you mentioned as well, Sal. And I think, being that this is a shared experience, I would love for anyone that could share, how does it feel to be linking up in this moment, all of you coming together in this reunion? I mean, obviously we're doing it for such a wonderful cause, the Ray and Science Foundation, but how does it feel for all of you four to be here on the same stage in the same room, making this once-in-a-lifetime reunion happen?
It feels like family. I mean, all these guys that we've known for years and years online, you know, we don't know their face, we don't know their names, we know their ats. So they come up to us and they introduce us themselves to us, and we're like, what's your at? Oh, okay, yeah, you're that guy. That girl. So it's great. We feel like family.
That's amazing. I love that. I assume that's probably a shared sentiment from everyone here, that familial sense. You know, I have to say, I love that the familial sense is coming from something where my favorite part of it is ripping someone's spine out of their body, and that's family.
Family. It's a friendship.
I see what you did there.
So, you know, the four of you, like we said, you guys created the original Mortal Kombat, like the original trilogy. You know, working on Mortal Kombat in all these various capacities, you must have faced several different highs and lows. Do you have any particular memories or experiences you could share from your development time?
Yeah, highs and lows. My memory of it was mostly just in the studio as we were recording. John and Ed, you know, had put together the script that they wanted for the character, and just trying to, like, we just had a good time while we were coming up with ideas for the different things, and just talking through it. And then their implementation of the actions that you capture is nothing like, you know, you don't know what it's going to be until they actually put it into the game. And once they put it into the game, it's like, oh my God, that's what you did with that pose I was on. And it's like, so when I see that stuff, I'm like elated. As a game developer, I'm elated with just like how great they can make something look from almost nothing. So that's the way I think about it.
Yeah, please, John.
So sitting next to Carrie and Sal, the one thing about Carrie and Sal when we were doing the digitizing way back when was they were both very physically capable of doing the moves and the motion. And one thing I remember about the both of them was that they were very good on the treadmill. Yeah. I remember Carrie and Sal both had a good cadence with their run. And that was very important because other folks were not so good on the treadmill. They'd stumble around a little bit, but they were both fantastic. And they both would throw themselves around. I remember on the mats, they were game for anything that we asked them to do. And then even when we weren't taping, just if we would get together like socially or whatever, you know, after the tapings or whatnot, they would still just beat the hell out of each other. carry constantly throwing Sal around left and right, and it was a lot of fun. So,
anything for entertainment. Right. So yeah.
Sal was a brother I never wanted.
I guess you know what I had heard from your question was what were the highs and what some of the highs, some of the lows. You know, the highs would probably be when we were testing the first game and seeing a big crowd of people around it, getting just that you know, visceral reaction to seeing things for the first time. The lows would probably be, you know, we've had those days we worked, you know, really crazy hours. You basically just dedicated your life to the game. You woke up, you went right into work, or you woke up at work and you just worked through the whole thing. But that was how we were doing the games. But it was draining for all of us. But at the end of the day, when you you're in a group like this, you know, you forget about all that and you just think about the win. So huge sacrifice, huge personal sacrifice. You know, I think, you know, we've all had summers that were just blown because we were, you know, working so hard.
These guys would have couches in their offices, and the couches weren't for sitting on. They were for taking naps.
Absolutely, absolutely. And so the sacrifice was extreme, but then when we would see reactions and we would see, you know, movies being made and animated features and comic books and all that stuff, that really made up for those lows.
You know, Ed just reminded me of something. So when I think of highs, because I get asked a lot about, when did we know? You know, when did we know that MK was going to be a success and whatnot? And I think about the first time we tested, it was our first weekend test. And the way we tested coin-op games back at Midway was we would do a prototype in just a plain black cabinet. And I think the first Mortal Kombat game, we did like a Xerox copy marquee. And we tested at an arcade in Chicago called Times Square. And I remember they wheeled the game in, and it was just a plain black cabinet. And it was a Friday, so it was probably packed. And I remember them turning it on. Maybe it was Al Lasko. I forget who rolled the machine into the arcade. And you remember Al Lasko was, yeah, one of the mechanics. And all I remember was there was a Street Fighter machine just down the way, like, you know, several games over, and a pack of players around it. And I just remember thinking, what are we doing here? It's like, how are we going to compete with this game? Look, it's just got this crowd. And so they turned the machine on, and there it sat alone with nobody playing it. And I thought, oh, we're dead. We're not going to do well. And then I remember the first player walked over, put a token in, played the game, and then ran over and tapped his friend on the shoulder and, like, told him about this game. And then he went over, and then they were both playing it. And then slowly everybody migrated over. And at some point on that Friday night, we saw the crowd had migrated from Street Fighter over to MK. And I think that's when we realized there's got to be something special about this game. And we kind of felt that during development. We felt that there was something special. People around the office were excited about it. But it was that first night, I think we understood that there was something special about the game.
And that same weekend, we would see, you would recognize a face, and it was somebody who came in there on a Friday night. We saw them Saturday morning. They stayed the whole day. We saw them Sunday morning. They stayed the whole night. And then when they took the game away, the arcade was saying that they were getting phone calls. When are you gonna bring this Mortal Kombat game back into the arcade? And it just spread like wildfire. We got calls from New York. You know, our distributors were saying, you know, what is this new game you're testing? I think at that point we knew. Again, the whole thing, when somebody would do a fatality and somebody is so excited that they just have to physically run around just to get it out of their system, that we really knew something was hitting at that point.
Yeah, and still, you guys, I remember watching the games. Whenever we watched a game that we put on test, just watching people's reactions and seeing where their eyes lit up, or and sometimes worse, is where they were confused about something. It's like, oh, how do you do this one thing? I don't get this. And so while we were watching games on test, we would notate that and then go back to the office, sometimes that very night, and like make fixes. Like, okay, they got confused. What's that? Yeah, yeah. So yeah, we'd burn the updates at that point. It was like these hard to actually create ROMs that we would put into the machines, and then we'd run back the next night, plug in the updates that we made the night before, and see what, like, if that corrected the confusion that we saw. So it was, that's always the, like, the, that was always, like, the way we did things. We would study people playing it, and we weren't allowed to interfere either.
Right. You know, the funny thing about it was at the time, we were young enough that we could blend in with the crowd of players. So people didn't realize that we were the actual developers, and they thought we were just players standing in line waiting to play the game. But it was great because we got to observe their behaviors, and we could study what they were doing without them understanding who we were.
Yeah, we couldn't. We definitely couldn't do that now.
Right.
There's no way we'd get away. Maybe Carrie would, but I don't think the three of us can get away with it.
Honestly, I think what I want to say thank you for, because I missed this, and I don't know, maybe Phantom, you do, the quarter on the cabinet winner stays mentality. That, to me, is something that I wish the kids nowadays would have, but it just doesn't exist. But it's just, it's that same feeling that you mentioned, Sal, of that connected tissue of people coming together. Phantom, do you remember that stuff, too?
Yeah, you know, the whole getting to play with your friends, even the Super Nintendo versions, getting to sit around and kind of interact with each other. You know, I'm super curious. The fact that you were there seeing this happen, how did the player feedback kind of determine how you were going to advance the game?
Well, from our standpoint, it was just six characters. So I do think that we felt like we needed more in there. So we pulled the game back in, and we added a character. And, you know, and we had no female characters in the game, so we added the Sonya character into the game. And I think it gave us the confidence to say, let's bet a little bit more on this game.
Oh, that's right. So that reminds me, when we did our first weekend test, it was just the six characters minus Sonya. And then I think we saw it got such a good reaction that our management gave us more time to work on the game. So we got to fine-tune the game, we got to add an additional character, and then we re-released the game. I think we did a longer test, like a week test, maybe a couple months later. Yeah.
I think what's so definable about the Mortal Kombat experience, too, is that the characters are so rich and you connect to them. And I would love to know from Carrie and Sal, how does that, like, come into your creation of the characters, knowing that just the way that they present themselves in this motion capture game that's ahead of its time, how do you take that on as a performer, as an actor, as a motion capture artist? How did that process come together for you?
Yeah, that inspires your performance. Like, you see the concepts, you hear about what the character is about, and then you present a persona that's based on that, and you try to add your own spice to it. And then sometimes you go too far. It's like, yeah, don't do that. Yeah, whatever you're doing right now, stop that. And then you go, okay, sorry. And this character is more about this. And then so we would do things. But again, it's like I attribute everything to the developers, the designers that have been, you know, worked hard thinking about it, worked hard about how this character, like, works and fits into the whole scheme of the suite of different characters, the movesets, and all of that. But as far as, like, the character acting, for me anyway, it's like compared to making the game, you know, it's work, but compared to making the game, it's just a small part of it.
You know, the two of you, actually, did you have any martial arts experience? Carrie, I believe you might have had some when you first started the games.
Yeah, I was like a yellow belt. I had no idea. I was like a copycat, you know. Even with my first game, NBA Jam, I didn't know how to cheerlead. I was the art student who, you know, wore the hoodie and, you know, kept to herself during lunch. You know, I would skip lunches just so I didn't have to socialize.
That was me too, to be fair. I'm not right there with you.
Yeah. So not much martial art experience, but I was a gymnast, and I had some boxing and wrestling experience, so that helped me a lot. So I think Carlos was on the side, and I was just copying whatever he did. But Sal had more insider information than I did. I was an outsider coming in. I had no idea what Mortal Kombat was. I did a couple more video games before Mortal Kombat 3 came on. And the time that I actually realized that it was big is when I went on tour. And we would finish a show. I would come out, and there would just be these hordes of children wanting my autograph, you know, sticking, you know, papers in front of my face, or the play or the programs or whatever, wanting it. And I would stay there and sign every single book until all those kids were gone, because I thought, this is temporary. you know, I'm never ever going to have this experience again in my life, so I'm going to relish it. And here I am 30 years later, still doing the same thing.
And I never had a lot of real martial arts training. I watched the hell out of Bruce Lee, though. Bruce Lee, Steven Seagal, Jean-Claude Van Damme, and I would just imitate them, like to every effect, all their poses, but I never had the discipline to actually go to a real martial arts school and do the real work and the real thing. But, but I got, and I watched pro wrestling a lot, so I threw a little bit of that in there as well.
You know, but you, I think both of you were very, again, I mentioned earlier, very physically capable of doing anything that we asked you to do, right? So it was, I think you were able to mimic a lot. Like, we'd show you, hey, we want you to do something like this, and you guys would just mimic it.
And I'd already practiced that stuff, you know, for 20 years before that, just pretending like I was Bruce Lee, so
right,
yeah,
right.
And Jean-Claude.
Yeah, I got a rude awakening when I went on tour, because I was a yellow belt coming in with these 20 black belts who were going on tour with me, and they wanted me because I was the character in the video game, and I did the promo work and all that stuff before each show. So I had 20 black belts acting like my big brother, kicking my ass every single day. They resented me. They hated me. They didn't want me to be on tour with them. So I had to show up every day. We worked for 3 months in the Catskill Mountains for 12 hours a day. I was hallucinating. I was so tired. But I got through it, and it was really great training.
This was for the this was the Mortal Kombat live tour that was produced in the mid-90s. Yeah, it was awesome.
And the one thing I would say about watching movie stars do their martial arts versus real martial artists is that movie stars sell for the camera. They don't fight for real. Like, when you see what they're doing, nobody would ever do that. Like, in an MMA match, you'd never see the stuff that nowadays you kind of do. But you'd never really see that. And it's because they're selling for the camera. Whereas a lot of, classically trained and officially trained martial artists, they don't know how to sell because they're doing things practically. They're doing things very like, this is how you would legitimately do this action, but it doesn't sell sometimes. So I think that's how I'm going to justify my part in that. Yeah.
I mean, it's Kerry, to a point you made before, I get it, like the fake it till you make it kind of situation, discovering all, as my acting coaches used to say, the best actors are the best thieves, right? No one knows that you're stealing something. And I appreciate as well, Sal, the whole wrestling. If I was a Mortal Kombat character, I think I'd be like Stone Cold Steve Austin, right?
I think I'd be like Striker, you know, one of the average people who got mixed into it all. Like, it happens. Yeah. So, you know, Ed and John, every sequel to Mortal Kombat, you know, from the original all the way up to, like, you just kept making advancement after advancement, even up to the current releases. I'm super curious to know, what was the approach to Mortal Kombat 3 as a follow-up? Like, what was your overall mindset in comparison? Because Mortal Kombat 2 was a game changer. Like, that became so big. But then what kind of incentivized you to keep going with Mortal Kombat 3 and make it what it did?
Yeah, and that was my absolute favorite, personally. I loved MK3.
I think, to some extent, we didn't want to just repeat the last game. You know, Mortal Kombat 2 was such a significant jump forward in terms of the visuals. You know, it played better. You know, everything we learned from the first game we applied to Mortal Kombat 2. And I think it would have been safe, and we probably could have gotten away with just making Mortal Kombat 2.5 and calling it Mortal Kombat 3. But we wanted to mix things up, so we added a run button and whatnot. And at first, the response was, you know, there was like a resistance to it. It was kind of like, you know, this is not like the game that I played. But after a while, players started really getting into the aggressive nature of it. And as far as competitive-wise, like if you say which game is the most competitive, I think Ultimate MK3 is more competitive than Mortal Kombat 2, even though Mortal Kombat 2, it was such a big leap from MK1 to MK2. Again, the visuals I thought were just such a significant jump forward in MK2.
Yeah, and I remember back then, the visual change was so strong in MK from MK2 to MK1 that I remember when you were talking about MK3, you're like, how do we top this? I remember you guys having this conversation. It was in a plane. Then you guys started talking about things like adding new novel you know, modes, like even the uppercut that went through the area above and then landed someplace, landed like in a different level now, and you're playing in a different level, and then the run button, like you said. So I remember you guys were always trying to come up with these novel new things that would up the game. You can't just visually, it's like we were like peaked out visually for that tech. And that all stuck to my head as a developer.
Sure. You know, one thing I remember about the transition from MK1 to 2 was MK1, we were working on such a compressed schedule that we had to make tough choices about how we were going to produce the digitized graphics that you saw in the game. And I had just come from a couple of games that I had worked on where there was very heavy, like everything was pretty much hand-drawn and animated. And I think we realized pretty quickly that there's just not enough time to touch every pixel, which is what would have been required. And so we really, on the first Mortal Kombat, just kind of gave in to the raw nature of the digitized graphics. And then when it came time to MK2, we had a little bit more time. I think we had a little bit more memory, maybe some more colors to work with.
More artists,
right? We added Tony Goski had joined the team. And so we had, because of the more time, I think we were able to kind of fine-tune our approach to the visual qualities of what we had produced. And I think similar with MK3, I think by the time MK3 had come out, some of the what you see in the background environments were produced in 3D,
yeah.
Right? So we did some modeling there. The methods that we used to produce the digitized graphics had been so fine-tuned. We had custom development tools that were created for us to utilize to create, you know, to work with digitized sprites. And so it really, the process was streamlined, and I think you kind of saw it in the quality level of what we were doing. The one thing about MK3 that I remember being upset about in the beginning was Ed decided to add the, you know, the running. It was Ed's idea, and so we kind of talked about it. And I remember Ed breaking the news to me. I have this great idea. We're going to add this run button, and this is what it's going to do. But we got to make the character smaller. Oh. And I was so upset by it. Wait, what do you mean smaller? They're supposed to get bigger. But we ended up making the characters just slightly smaller. I don't know, about 5-10 pixels or something smaller. But it ended up working out really well because I think the run button just kind of changed the aggressive nature of kind of how you played the game.
Yeah, and I think that also influenced a lot of fighting games as an overall. If I could use a pronoun to describe the Mortal Kombat franchise, innovation would be what that is. Not just with acting or run buttons or all the things in between. It is the full package that makes an innovative game.
Innovative and visceral, I would say.
Visceral is a good word there. I would definitely say so. But those things, both innovative and visceral, well, it draws attention. And as Mortal Kombat, it fits into the larger tapestry of the history of video games. And I like to draw us to 1994 and the congressional hearings as, you know, the shades of how does the game industry answer to the American government? And you're seeing these congressional hearings come out. If anyone could speak to what that meant to them, like you're seeing yourselves appear on the Congress floor, Lieberman is talking about it, maybe your characters are appearing on C-SPAN. This is such a pivotal moment in time, the creation of the ESRB. Can anyone speak to this moment in time?
I think we were looking at it from the standpoint of video games were getting more and more sophisticated, and, you know, the record industry had a label for, you know, explicit lyrics or something. Movies forever had rated R, rated PG, PG-13, and all that. Even television had ratings, and video games was kind of like the last one to kind of jump onto the bandwagon. So by no means when we were making the first game were we thinking, I can't wait for a six-year-old to play this game. You know, nobody was thinking that. We were thinking, at some point we realized that some of the ratings was necessary, and it was something that we agreed with. You know, we didn't, and so once Mortal Kombat 2 came out and it had the M rating on it, and it had, you know, everybody, it was kind of like on board with the ESRB. From our perspective, the objection died down. It was just like, oh, this is like an R-rated movie. This is something.
You know, the one thing about video games at the time, this is early, mid-90s, I think when this all started to kind of come about, is that video games back then were kind of thought of as toys, you know, toys for kids. And I think that the realization was happening that these kids who are playing games, they're not stopping. Like, I was still playing, I was a developer, but I was still playing games. But my friends were all still playing games, and they're now in their 20s. And I think there was the realization that games aren't this thing created for kids. Games are, they're for all ages, just like film and television. There's content and media created for people of all ages. And different games appeal to different age groups. And I think games, I think now, of course, are very different from what they were back then. But back then, especially coming out of the 80s, there was, of course, there was the coin-op market, but I think the especially the home console market was thought of as these things are being produced for kids, and that was changing in the 90s. It was changing because, again, no one stopped. I didn't stop. I'm sure a bunch of folks out in the crowd, you didn't stop playing video games. Everybody just kept playing. So that was a change that kind of occurred at that point in time.
When all this was occurring, you know, we had, you know, my favorite finisher move, friendships, and then there was also the babalities. Was this a direct response to that type of drama that was happening, or was it, you know, just one more variation you wanted to add to the game?
I think I do remember having a conversation with John about it, and, you know, I think I shouldn't speak for John, but I think in my head, we were kind of making a statement of it's not just the violent aspect, but it's also the secret aspect. There's, you know, how do you do Liu Kang's friendship move? How do you do Shang Tsung's friendship move? And it fell in the same category as a fatality move or animality after MK3. And we were just kind of saying, look, we can do something really stupid and it'll still be fun. It's not just the violent part of it.
Definitely fun, and I love the secret element of that, because I remember spending hours trying to master getting those combinations, and the satisfaction of being able to figure that out, it's great. And I also want to address this question, Carrie, to you, because the legacy of Sonya Blade, it continues to inspire fans to this day. How do you see the legacy of that character and your involvement with that character continue to develop in the world, and how Sonya Blade and how she's affected you?
Oh my God, she's affected me quite a bit in my life. She was a very strong female character, and when I was on tour, I could see all these little girls looking up to me. I would get letters from girls saying, I want to be just like you, and it would inspire me more to be stronger and learn how to fight and all that stuff. And as I grew and I became a mom myself, and I had my own children. My two twins that I had first were severely disabled, so it kind of gave me that inner strength to keep going and not complain. You know, life is life. You handle it. Whatever it gives to you, you handle it and stay positive. You know, and I don't want to sit here and preach and stuff, but she really, really did inspire me to stay strong, and I think that's why I haven't let her go, and I think that I still embrace it. It's just a part of me now. She's just a part of me.
I think inspiration is definitely a large part of the legacy of Sonya Blade. I think we can agree, can't we, everybody?
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, I like to just take this moment just to reflect back on the Radiant Science Foundation, since we're up here and we're talking about this. Like, the fact that Sonya Blade inspired so many, you know, it's kind of the same story as Raiden. So if you hadn't had the chance yet, please go check out that booth.
Certainly. And let's open up a question I think would affect anybody that's involved in the franchise. Looking back at it, what are you most proud of in the Mortal Kombat franchise, both in terms of creation, influence, maybe character development, or taking on those roles? What do you look back at and you say, if I'm going to hang my hat on that one thing that I am so proud of that I did that, what would that be?
For me, it was just the fact that it's still around after 30, what year is this? 32 years.
Time is funny.
Is funny. Yeah, and you know, again, the, you know, to me, it was a sweet spot of technology, digitized characters. People don't realize just how big the lore of Mortal Kombat was. You know, the first game was just little paragraphs of the characters, but players just attached themselves to, you know, Liu Kang's my guy, or Raiden's my guy, or Sonya's my girl. And I really think that that plays such a significant role in Mortal Kombat's success. It was not only this crazy, really fast-paced, violent, visually different than anything, but these characters, to this day, they're making a movie about Scorpion and his you know, the rivalry with Sub-Zero in the Netherrealm and all that stuff. They're still doing it to this day. And I think that it's not just the visuals of what the character looks like, what the cool stuff the characters do, and the story behind them. I think that's a significant part of its longevity, from my perspective.
Yeah, I would say very similar to Ed. You know, the one thing that when I think back on the creation of, especially the first game in hindsight, and the conditions that we created it, you know, under, the one thing about MK, again, you can look at it in hindsight, is, and I've expressed this before, is that game and what it kind of became in those, you know, back in the early games, really was a conglomeration of kind of who Ed and I were at the time, and like the things we grew up loving, and everything that made us who we were at the time, we just like threw it all at Mortal Kombat. And people always point out, like, hey, they can see a little bit of this book or this character or this film or this song or whatever, you know, in the game. And that really is because we literally just took everything about who we were at the time and put it into this game as best we could. And it really was kind of an expression of who we were at the time. And that just, the fact that that resonated the way that it did, really is, we're very lucky that it happened, you know, the way that it did. But I'm very proud that it really was very organic. Like, it wasn't, you know, so there was a lot of planning, a lot of hard work in it that, you know, that we put into it. But the fact that we really just took these things that we loved and tried to weave it together and express it through that game worked out the way that it did. I'm very proud of that. And it's I think we're very fortunate that it happened the way that it did. But again, in hindsight, looking back at it, it really was a kind of a pure expression of who we were and the things that we consumed as kids, even growing up. So,
yeah, and as a developer, like working next to you guys, is this thing on? Yeah, it is. As working next to you guys, I remember just kind of watching from afar the principles that you guys used when executing on stuff, with implementing stuff. We talk about all the time, like when, and the visceral feelings that you guys talk about and get, like there's a way of doing that that not everybody does, which is why not every game has it. But there are principles that are employed, like when somebody gets hit. Firstly, the pose, the posturing of it, you know, then the impact point. The camera will shake. The player will move a certain way. The audio happens a certain way. At the right level, the right type of audio happens. The right type of effect happens off of them. And all of those things together, I think, are things that not everybody does. And if you do it right, that's where you go, like, that's the difference between, like, when you go see a Marvel movie versus, like, a, you know, some, you know, low budget movie. There's principles that they're using that make you go, oh, that sell what's happening. And that was happening all throughout the Mortal Kombat creation. And I took a lot of that stuff into my wrestling games, into the games that I did in the future, where it was a similar type of thing. And I think you guys should be proud of that, of having the foresight, or at least the knowledge base, to say, yeah, we should do this to sell it better. We should do this to make this feel, or you know what, scrap this. We don't like this. This isn't working out. Let's do something else altogether, or whatever. So anyway, that's from outsider looking in. That's what I
think. Yeah, real quick. It was funny because the one thing about the games that we did at Midway back in the day, you know, we produced them in these coin-op cabinets that had actually a really good sound system.
Yeah.
And if you cranked the audio, you'd hear the thunder of the bass. Yeah. And I remember, I had worked on a game called Smash TV, and you'd walk into an arcade and you'd hear the rumble of all the explosions and the shooting and stuff, and
yeah,
that had an effect. And then MK was similar. You know, Ed kind of calling Dan Fortin's the sounds that he did, but it was the sound of the uppercut, yeah, was the most, it was like a calling card. You'd walk into an arcade and you'd hear the boom of the uppercut.
Yeah,
and
stuff
that was pretty cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I want to see a show of hands. Like, Mortal Kombat has changed a lot of people's lives. It's inspired them. It's made them healthy. It's done all these things. How many of you have played this game as a young kid and you decided that this changed your life for the better? Right there. That's what we can hang our hat on.
Carrie, that was goosebumps inducing. I felt that. Yeah. Did you feel that?
Oh, yeah. I raised my hand, too. You know, on Monday, Mortal Kombat 1 Chaos Reign is about to release, and we've seen this franchise just continue to grow year after year. So I'm really curious, what do you hope to see in the future of the franchise?
To me, there's two kind of directions. One is I do think we need to continue moving forward with new content, but there's a catalog of 30 years of games and a lot of high points and people's memories, right? You know, Shaolin Monks, you know, Deception Conquest, you know, all of these kind of pivotal moments. Some people entered, you know, the Mortal Kombat, like, I think some people here are probably born after the first game came out. And so a lot of people have kind of onboarded into Mortal Kombat. So I do see us, you know, I would love it if we could, like, kind of revisit some of those moments with the latest technology and you know, remasters and you know, another action-adventure game and all that stuff like that. I really feel like there's great opportunities for that.
Well, you got some good direct feedback there, Ed.
No objections, right.
anyone else, any insights on what you'd like to see out of the future?
I'd like to see Sonya Blade come back.
Oh, yeah, I think.
Yeah, you're never going to see her again. No, she clearly will make a return to Mortal Kombat.
I'm always happy to see Noob Saibot come back, because I think a lot of times, I don't know that anybody would understand even who I am or what my relationship to the series is if they didn't keep bringing that character back, so I'm very happy to see him come back.
So, you know, in the past, we've seen, like, Christopher Lambert, we've seen a lot of the original movie actors. Any chance we might see some of the digitized actors make an appearance in Mortal Kombat?
We've definitely talked about that. unfortunately, Carrie's very expensive, and we can't afford her at the moment. But no, we've had some great movie skins, and we've definitely had, you know, we've had guest characters, but you know, Jean-Claude Van Damme as Johnny Cage and whatnot. But we've definitely had conversations about bringing. The classic arcade actors, you know, scanning their faces and getting all that into the game. I think that would be really cool.
Who else would like to see that?
You know, I love these panels. We get such great direct feedback. It's awesome.
Yeah, they're right there in your face, clapping. I love it.
Speaking of direct feedback, you know, I would love to see if we have any questions from the audience. I've got my co-MC right over here, Molly Gannon. She's been working ever so diligently with Yanni. Yanni, what's up, man? Is there any question or two from the audience that we'd love to throw to the panelists?
Oh, yeah. We got a ton of questions over here. Thank you guys so much. Yeah. They're excited. They've got tons of great questions. Are you ready for them?
You know, I think we have time for one or two. I think it'd be great. Maybe three. Let's see what we can do.
All right. Awesome. First, we all just want to say thank you so much, seriously, for making such a big impact on our lives. Thank you, seriously. We've got a beautiful question right here from Hendrick. He says, which character just blows your mind that got so popular and so legendary that maybe you weren't expecting it?
So popular and not expecting, maybe Cabal. Because in the initial creation of Cabal, I wasn't very happy with him visually, the visual qualities of Cabal. Fortunately, Ed, I think it was your idea to give him super speed, kind of like the Flash. Ed has always been a big fan of the Flash. I think he was a fun, playable character in MK3. But they brought him back like in the new film, and it's like he's lived this life that I never had anticipated it, you know, that we'd still be talking about Cabal all these years later. So very happy about him.
All right. We have a question from Sam. Have you considered a modern take on the photo-captured style from the original Mortal Kombat?
Yeah. Actually, there was a project that got started that had, you know, much higher resolution. I think they were 3D models, but they certainly looked like photorealistic versions of the character. And it was like kind of remakes of the classic arcade games. They've started and unfortunately, you know, hit snags that I'm not allowed to really discuss, but you know, they've stalled them. But that's certainly something that's always on our minds, is to, like, someday it would be great to, you know, bring back a, like a Mortal Kombat 2 or Ultimate Mortal Kombat 3 in today's technology. It was always, you know, one day the stars are going to align and we'll make that happen.
That's great, because you've actually answered multiple questions in one with that.
Awesome. We got a few more, if that's all right.
I mean, honestly, those are two great questions, Phantom. I think we should get a few more of them out there. You got a great audience here. Let's keep it going.
Yeah, all right. Awesome. Thank you guys for your questions. We've got Neji says, for Ed, how does designing current Mortal Kombat games now compare to how it was in the beginning? Is it tougher creating the game now that you're creating it for a more competitive or a more casual player?
It certainly didn't... It doesn't take any less time from me personally, just because when we made the first Mortal Kombat game, it was four of us. Me, John, Dan Forden, and John Vogel. And we did it in 8 months, right? You know, from beginning to end. Now the games are 2+ years, 3 years long. There's, you know, hundreds of people who work on it, different studios. It's much more different than it is difficult. What we were doing was a lot more, I guess, establishing the franchise and really kind of set the foundation. And the new games are much bigger in production. The story is much more, there's a whole group that's just doing the story mode. So it's different. It's just, you know, I used to be the only programmer on the team, and I haven't written code in 20 years, something like that. So it's just a very different experience.
No applause?
No applause for that? Or... All right. No, please, no.
But keep going. Yanni, do you got a question for us?
Yes, we do, from Evil Emperor X. Ed, you
okay,
once
Okay, great
said...
name, first off.
Yes. He is the meme machine on Mortal Kombat Twitter. You once said, Ed, that Quan Chi's leg rip was your favorite fatality and that his neck stretch was your least favorite. Now, have you or anybody in the rest of the group developed any new favorite or least favorite fatalities?
Yeah, the leg rip, and that was actually our CEO at the time, Neil Nicastro, came up with that stupid idea. And I don't know if I ever said it was my favorite, but there have been more... And the next stretch is just plain old embarrassing for me.
I would love to. Does anyone else here have a favorite fatality, or you know, just to share with the audience?
You know, that's very coincidentally. That's what we always ask at the end of the Roamcast too. So I'm very eager to hear what each of your favorite finisher or fatality would be.
I think I answer this different. I get asked this question a lot, and I probably answer it different all the time. I would say it would either be Kano's heart rip or Sub-Zero's neck rip from the first game. Because those, I remember when we tested the game back then, seemed to get the biggest reaction.
Yeah, the spine rip was John's idea. And I do remember saying to him, no, there's no way we can get away with that. You know, like it was from Predator and all that stuff. And I think it's arguably the most iconic one that's shown on TV that's kind of defines Mortal Kombat.
That's mine, too. It's my favorite as well, the spine rip.
Great answer.
Mine's the kiss of death, of course.
I mean, how do you argue with that? I'm partial to the reptile eats the person in the three parts.
Oh, when he takes off the mask and, yeah, there we go.
That's great. I think we have time maybe for two more Q&A questions.
Awesome. Well, kind of on that same note, we have a question from Jessica. She says, what is the worst fatality cutout scene that has ever been pitched to you?
You know, I remember back I don't remember whether it was MK2. I think it was MK2. I had actually done some animations of guts spilling out. Baraka was going to slice a guy in the midsection, and then the guts were going to spill out onto the floor or whatever. And I think we were like, that we can't, it was like we felt like we were pushing it too far back then, but that was one that we opted to self-edit. No one ever told us no.
And it's like
anything.
Nothing now. It's like our more mild fatalities.
Right, compared to the new games, yeah, it's nothing.
All right, and this question comes from Anonymous. What has been the difference between MK95 and MK2021 regarding yourself or the studio's official involvement?
Oh, God, that's a... You know, in MK95, John and I actually went onto the set. We flew to California, and I don't think we really steered the script much, did we? We did.
Well, we did get versions of the script, and I know we compiled notes and shared notes with Larry.
Did they do anything about it, or?
I think maybe they did early on. It was very early on.
Oh, right, the Kano eye patch.
And there was all kinds of stuff. Yeah,
right.
They had...
That's right.
Yeah, right. In the first MK film, they were testing versions, I remember this, versions of our characters that looked nothing like their versions in the game. And I guess they did some focus testing, and the players fortunately reacted negatively to the changing of the characters. They're like, well, that's not Scorpion, and that's not Kano. And so they made them look more like the characters from the game.
The 2021 one was... I think I saw a script, but it was very late into the production, and there wasn't really much room to make modifications or change things, whatnot.
All right. So, I mean, with that, we're coming pretty close to a close here.
It's been great. This has been an amazing experience here, I have to say.
It really has. And Carrie, I don't mean to put you on the spot, but would you feel comfortable showing everybody? I was surprised to learn recently that your friendship dance was not just some digitized sprite thing, but it's actually a dance you can do. Would you feel comfortable doing that for the crowd?
Oh, my God.
Oh, it was the arm.
It was not a dance. It was me waiting for them to reboot the computer and just goofing off. The camera was still rolling, and... the computers would crash because they didn't have enough RAM because these, you know, we were doing Pioneer stuff, you know, and the computers couldn't keep up with it. So there's me waiting.
Thank you.
And then they made up my friendship.
Talent. That
was... Thank you so much, Carrie.
That's great. I love just how much it really has come out that you truly are not just a family with each other, but all this great audience coming out here. And I think that we just have to say a big thank you to each and every one of you for coming, not just to the show, but having this reunion panel here today. So thank you, truly, on behalf of all of us
here. This has been so fun. I've had a great time meeting everyone, like even playing against a bunch of people who I beat every single one of, right? Right? Yeah, it was great.
That's the story, and we're sticking to it, right? Well, of course, if you haven't had a chance to, of course, you can go over to their area. You can sign up to get an autograph or picture. It's all in help of the Raiden Science Foundation. And, John, I think you and I and, of course, Yanni over there are going to be joining tomorrow here on the main stage for a drawing seminar. So we can't wait for that.
Yeah, looking forward to it. I'm going to draw, I guess, one of the characters live on camera. So it'll be fun. And then I think they're going to raffle the drawing off.
That's right. For our RSF, Rain Science Foundation, final push. That is our last thing here on the main stage. It's going to be at 2:30, and the drawing seminar is going to be at 1 o'clock.
Okay.
Again, two big not-to-miss events, and you could walk away with original art. I think that's pretty cool.
That's right.
Yeah, guys, the reason that us four are here is because of little Raiden over there. So to say thanks, go over there and donate. $5, whatever, just something. Everything counts. You know, we are trying to find a cure for UBA5. And, you know, it grabs my heart. This little boy, he reminds me so much of my own sons, but my own sons don't have a death sentence. And right now, Raiden does. So if you guys could go over there and donate, you know, whatever you can afford, we all appreciate it. We want this little boy to live because he's an amazing little boy.
He really is. I just got to meet him, and what a wonderful spirit Raiden has. And it's the God of Thunder that's all propelling us forward to make a difference in the fight. But I think there's only one last thing that we can do. Ed, would you mind terribly? Get over here! Ladies and gentlemen, please get to your feet and give a massive round of applause to our amazing Mortal Kombat panelists here.
What do you think, guys? 3, 2, 1, we all say thank you together. Ready? 3.